Welcome to the Grace Cup Ministry. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Rejoice and be glad in it. I don't know about you, but I'm rejoicing today.
Amen.
Today we have Pastor Curtis L. Johnson, Jr., the New Jerusalem Baptist Church, Missionary Baptist Church. This is our second year anniversary.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And on the first year, we had Pastor, and he's back again.
Amen.
So praise God for him. And now we will have prayer, the Reverend Ella McDonald, Kingdom Building Ministry. Let's pray.
Let us pray. Father God, as again we come, we thank you for grace and mercy today.
Yes, thank you,
Father,
Lord.
We thank you for your son, Jesus, today. We thank you for salvation today. Father God, we thank you for 2 years of broadcasting today, Lord. Father, we ask you to continue to bless this Grace Cup Ministry, oh God, as it goes forth, oh God. Father, we thank you for no matter how the weather were or whatever, Lord, you allowed us to come out. Because you know somebody was in the nursing home, convalescent home. Somebody was waiting just to hear a word from you. And Father, we thank you for that. Oh God, we thank you for you being so good. Father, we ask you to continue to bless. We ask you to heal. We ask you to deliver in the name of Jesus, Lord. Father, we ask you to bless those in the hospital today, Lord. Bless those in convalescent home. Whatever's going on with them today, Lord, we ask you to touch in the name of Jesus. Father God, we ask you to bless the man of God today, oh God, as the word come forth, that somebody hear a word from you today. Today, Lord, and they will turn their lives around, God, and they will give their lives to you. Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in this program today. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and thank God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And praise God. He's a wonderful God, isn't he?
Hallelujah.
He's a wonderful God. And thank him for allowing us to come before him in prayer.
Hallelujah.
Men ought to always pray. Praise God. And let's hear now from evangelist Mevlin Alexander. She was on our first show a year ago.
Amen.
She's going to sing today, "He Keeps Doing Great Things for Me." And after that, Pastor Curtis Johnson. God bless you.
Oh, I'd praise bless his name with everyone. Yes, I would. Oh, and if I had 10,000 hands, oh, I'd use them all to lift his name. For he knows me better, much better than anyone else. He takes better, better care. He keeps on doing it, keeps on doing, keeps on doing it, keeps on doing it, Lord, you keeps on doing it, keep on doing it, Jesus, keep on doing it, keeps on doing it, Lord, need you, keep on doing it, keeps on doing it, keeps on doing it, keeps on doing it when I'm sick. When I'm down, nobody around, you're always there to pick me up, turn me around, place my feet on solid ground. Yeah, keep on doing it, keeps on doing it. Oh, keeps on doing it, keeps on doing it. Oh, keep on doing it, God, when I need you, keeps on doing it, Lord. When I'm by myself, you keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keeping me together, making me brand new, regenerating my spirit, keeps on doing it, healing my body, healing my spirit, keeps on doing it, keeps on doing it. Oh, he keeps doing great things for me. Oh, yeah. He keeps on doing great things for me.
Well, greetings, beloved of God. It is our delight and our pleasure to be here once again at the Grace Cup Ministry. We certainly pay homage and respect to missionary Marietta Johnson and the fine work that she's doing with this wonderful ministry, celebrating 2 years. My, how time flies, and we certainly praise God for what he's doing in and through this ministry. We certainly encourage you to continue to support this ministry with your prayers and whatever else the Lord lays upon your heart. Well, there is a word from the Lord, and we've been dealing with our church with something that the Lord's been impressing in my spirit as we've embarked upon this wonderful year of 2012, where I believe God is going to do some miraculous things. If you have your Bibles, turn with us to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Let's just pray. Gracious God, how we thank you for this day. We need you in a special way to speak to our hearts. Someone's tuned in right now that needs to hear from you to encourage their hearts. God, they're in a valley of indecision even now. And we pray by your word today that they're challenged and most of all, they're changed. Be glorified during this time. In Jesus' name, amen and thank God. Acts chapter 1, familiar passage of scripture for many of us. I just want to read a few verses in our hearings and leave your Bibles open because we'll be looking at some scripture today. All right, I'm reading from the New King James Version, chapter 1, verse 4. It says, "And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized you with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons, which the Father has put in his own authority. But you shall receive power with the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. I want to talk from a thought today, from vision to victory, from vision to victory. Well, it's amazing how many of us take this word vision so lightly and are for granted. To get a working definition of what vision is, it can almost be put as the faculty or state of being able to see. It is a blessing. It is a great thing to be able to see. In a verb form, you can say to be able to imagine. Or even you can say something seen in a dream, a trance, or a supernatural appearance that comes through revelation. Vision is important. Some may say it is a manifestation to the senses of something immaterial. Vision is necessary. One may say vision is just simply seeing what you see. Listen to a quote from one writer. It says that dissatisfaction and discouragement are not caused by the absence of things, but the absence of vision. That writer is suggesting that you may have things, you may want things, you may have a desire to have fine houses and wonderful jewelry and nice shiny cars, but in all of that, it's not so much that you don't have that stuff, it's a lack of vision. Can I tell you, my brothers and my sisters, friends, that it's necessary for us to have something within us to see further than the right now. Can I tell you, you're only going to go as far as your mind can take you. Yeah, that's why it's important that we guard our minds and we have our minds focused on God and things above. For it is our very minds that the devil will always try to attack, to try to get us to stop from pursuing the vision in which God has birthed within us. I'm convinced that vision is necessary in the life of not just believers, but those who want to succeed at life and to achieve great things. Listen to what one writer says. It says, the future belongs to those who see possibilities before they become obvious. Ooh, help me in here, Holy Ghost. It's necessary that we see the possibilities, we see afar off, even before it becomes obvious and a reality. The reason why inventors are sitting on millions of dollars right now, because they saw a possibility that somebody else may have saw, but they didn't put it into action. So thus, it was a possibility, but they brought it to a reality, and then they become an inventor. I want to challenge you today. What are you seeing that may not be obvious right now? What has God spoke in your spirit that you know that he wants to do in you and through you, but it's not a reality yet? What are you doing with the vision that God has placed in you? Well, beloved of God, I want to look at a few principles that I believe will bless you and help you. And some of these things we've been teaching at our church, and it's really been blessing the people, God. And I tell you, it's blessed me to see how God can deal with what he's already put inside of us. Note, my brothers and sisters, if you have any type of vision, you only have two options. You only have a man-made vision or a God-given vision. It is necessary that if you're going to be a kingdom citizen, one who has been bought with the precious price, you who have been saved by his power divine, then you want to make sure that you have a God-given vision and not a man-made vision. Because we might as well be honest, brothers and sisters, it's easy for us to have goals and aspirations. It's easy for us to look at our capabilities and our talents. And it's easy for us to look at our resources and say, I want to do this. I should do that. I can make a lot of money if I do that. By this time, I should be sitting here and I should be doing that. It's easy for us to say what we want to do. Many of you were told just like me, you can be whatever you want to be. You can do whatever you want to do. And to some truth, it's some truth to that. But can I tell you, once you have given your life to an almighty God, you ought to want to desire to be who God has called you to be. I know a good friend of mine who was a lawyer by practice. He practiced law, he made plenty of money, was doing very well. But then the Lord called him into ministry. And his friends, his colleagues, and some of his even his family members thought he was crazy, thought he was nuts to leave being a practicing attorney to be a pastor. They said, are you crazy? He said, it's what God has called me to do, and I want real victory in my vision. So he had to follow the call of God. Well, in this text today, and this is just our backdrop for where we're going today, you're well aware of Acts chapter 1 and how the Holy Spirit is promised. And I thank God that he left us a comforter. I thank God that he left his precious Holy Spirit to lead, guide, and direct us. He just doesn't come to make us feel good, but he gives us keeping power. I thank God for the power of the Holy Spirit. You understand that the book of Acts, it begins with a bang as Jesus, he speaks his final words to his men before ascending to heaven. Even though they were now leaders, not merely followers, they asked Jesus when his kingdom would come in Acts chapter 1, verse 6. Jesus doesn't tell them, but he instead communicates his vision about reaching the world. And that's what I like about Jesus. Jesus was a great communicator about his vision. He said, listen, I just didn't come to earth to make people feel good and to make people like me. I'm not on a popularity contest. He says, but I have vision. I came here with a purpose. Oh, bless his holy name. And I need to talk to us today because it's necessary that we are consistent to the things pertaining our purpose. I just said something right there. Listen, beloved God, it's easy for us to get distracted from the vision in which God has given unto us because we get busy doing stuff and we don't take time to fulfill vision and our purpose. So I suggest that many of us need to take a little time and look down our activity list for the day, for the month, for the week, and see, am I walking in destiny? Am I fulfilling purpose? Is God's will being done in and through my life? Understand that Jesus does not tell them, but he instead communicates this wonderful vision about reaching the world. And what I like about it in verse 8, he tells them what to do. Then he says, listen, they were thinking a defense, but Jesus was thinking offense. He literally begins to tell them that, yes, you're going to receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come on you. And then he goes on to say, now you're going to be witnesses. You're going to have the power that you need to get the assignment done. That's, I think I need to tell somebody, whatever the vision is, God will give you everything that is necessary to fulfill the vision. That ought to just bring a big old monkey off of somebody's back, because you've been burning yourself down. You've been worrying your mind. You've been pacing the floor trying to figure out, how am I going to get this taken care of? How am I going to get from point A to point B? How is this going to happen in me and through me? Let me tell you, listen, God does not call you to a place where he does not qualify you for. God does not bring you to a place where he's not going to bring you through. He says, listen, he instructs them to stay in Jerusalem until they receive the power they needed in order to go out and expand the kingdom little by little. I thank God that he's a progressive God. And he slowly moves them into this thing. He says, little by little, he says, you start in Jerusalem. Then you move, to Judea. And then expand into Samaria. And then ultimately, you're going to go to the ends of the earth. Yeah, this was no man-made vision, but this was a God-given vision. So if you just allow me a few moments just to share with you some differences, if you will, between man-made vision and God-given vision. Brothers and sisters, and I want you to write these down, you who are in your television, in your living rooms watching this television, write these down and kind of put on the scale, where am I at with what God is calling me to do? Number one, a man-made vision is created based on human gifts and skills. See, sometimes we think because of our gifting, what we have the ability to do, we will automatically think we will use that now to gain from it. Now, understand that God gives us gifts, talents, and we are to benefit. We can benefit from those. But let me tell you, you just don't base your vision on what you have the ability to do. Because watch this, God-given vision is received as a revelation. In other words, God reveals what he's going to do. Yeah, in a man-made vision, I think I can do this. But in a God-given vision, God shows me, yeah, what he's going to do. Secondly, understand, a man-made vision is fulfilled by staying ahead of others. You think you got to be one up on your neighbor, one up on your coworkers. But God-given vision is fulfilled through obedience. You're not concerned about what your neighbor is doing, about what your family members are doing. You know that God has called and destined and purposed you to do something. And you say, I'm going to walk in obedience. Watch this. Man-made vision sees similar organizations as competitors. But God-given vision seems similar organizations as complementary. And I share this at New J all the time. I tell the New J family, I said, listen, we are not in competition with any other church, any other ministry. I'm not in competition with any other pastor. I look at them as teammates. I thank God for them. I sow into the ministry. I pray for them because I'm not in competition. We are complementary. You got to know that just like God has called you, you're not the only one that can do something. I thank God that he's a God that's big enough that he can empower and enable others to do effective ministry. And there's some folks, help me here, Holy Ghost. There's some folks that will never receive from you, but they can receive from your brother. Isn't that good news to know that God is a God of versatility and variety, that he can have men and women, boys and girls to come and do various things, and ultimately he can get the glory out of it? So let me just throw this in for free today. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your energy. Don't waste your breath hating on anyone else. Learn how to celebrate what God is doing in the lives of your brothers and your sisters. Learn how to celebrate even what's going on in the lives of your enemies, because listen, you can't get ahead still trying to pull folks behind. Watch this. A man-made vision aims to grow the organization and generate revenue. You know, when you have a man-made vision, all you think about is numbers and dollar signs. how are we going to get more money? How are we going to get more people? That's a man-made vision. You're focused on the wrong thing. A God-given vision aims to serve people and advance God's kingdom. See, when I first came, I've been serving at the church here roughly around 2 years, And people say, well, how you going to grow the church? I said, I'm not worried about growing the church. It's not my job to grow the church. That's God's job. Hello. He will add to the church daily. He says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men, yeah, unto me. You got to learn how to serve people and advance God's kingdom. After all, if it's God's house, if it's God's vision, it ought to be God's agenda. Watch this. A man-made vision. Stress may emerge both inwardly and outwardly. I don't know how many people I can give you a list of people who are so frustrated in what they do and what they're going through, all because of the vision and that they're operating out of is man-made. They came up with it. God never told them to do it. God never ordained it. They just up and did it. And guess what? They're full of stress. They got bleeding ulcers, hairs falling out by the chunks, because they're operating out of a man-made vision. See, when you're operating in a God-given vision, you're not worried about how the bill's going to get paid. Because if God spoke it, if it's his will, you know it's his bill. I wish I had somebody praying with me. Listen. When it's a God-given vision, it's accompanied by an inward peace and an outward expression. You can know that, listen, not only is it, listen, there's an inward peace that says, I know God is working this thing out. I know God is providing. I know God is preserving. I know God is protecting. I know God will be glorified because this is his will. Now, let me just tell you, if you're walking in God's will and in God's way, you will face opposition. If it's truly God's vision, there's going to be something that comes against what God is trying to do. And I heard one old preacher say, he said, listen, if you're not being attacked by the enemy, you're not doing anything. Yeah. So I kind of feel all right when I'm going through an attack, when I got something coming against me. It reminds me of Brother Job. Listen, he said, has you considered my servant Job? Because Job was a perfect and upright man. He was doing something. Watch this. Finally, a man-made vision may be dropped for something better. You know, soon as something seems a little better, soon as the grass looks a little greener on the other side, we run, we shoot. But listen, a God-given vision is compelling and captivating until it is fulfilled. You keep on pressing, you keep on going until you see God bring the vision in which he spoke to pass. So it's imperative and important, my brothers and my sisters, that we learn how, as leaders, as children, as kingdom kids, to communicate the vision in which God has birthed and planted within us. And do you not know that when we share and communicate the vision, it makes others more comfortable helping us with the vision? You know, we're living in a day and hour where people think they ought to keep everything they know. You know, whatever happened to the generations that would show generations upcoming what they know? Because some stuff you can't get in a textbook. Some stuff you can't get through a university, through a college. You can't. Some stuff you got to get through experience.
Thank you for tuning in. And return next week for the ending of the wonderful, wonderful message that Pastor Curtis Johnson has given us.
Amen.
And we'll see you next week. God bless you.
Amen. All I can say is